Robert Murphy, a professor of infectious diseases at Northwestern University Feinberg School of Medicine. Good morning, doctor.
Good morning.
Your reaction to this news about Pfizer.
Well, this is great preliminary news from this study of 2,268 children, ages 5 to 11, and they're getting a beautiful immunologic response, just what we see in older kids and in adults at a fraction of the dose. They're getting just one-third of the dose that the older kids and adults are getting, and it's looking very good and very safe. They don't have any clinical data yet. They don't know about the hospitalization rate or anything like that, but this is like a wonderful marker in the right direction.
Let's talk about the FDA rejecting widespread boosters for all age groups. What are your thoughts on that?
I was against that because the data shows that this is just the Pfizer vaccine now. The data show very clearly that the antibody levels and the protection from being hospitalized goes down with time. And that's everybody. And there were data from Israel presented. It was a heated discussion, but they want more data, and they're going to approve it for people 65 and older and anybody at high risk, although high risk has not been defined. So it's not like it's not going to happen. It's going to happen in steps.
How much of a difference is there between Pfizer, Moderna, and Johnson & Johnson? And you may have heard Cedric the Entertainer last night on the Emmys make kind of a joke about it, that saying that one is much better than the others.
Well, now that we have more and more data, we're looking at everything more carefully, there is an indication that that the Moderna vaccine may, the benefits of, especially in terms of being hospitalized, protecting you from hospitalization, may last longer than the Pfizer vaccine, which is the same kind of category of vaccine, the mRNA vaccine. So there's this study, with thousands of people that, showed, actually like 8,000 people showed that the Moderna vaccine held up after 4 months in terms of preventing hospitalization. The Pfizer dropped off a little bit. Not too much. It went from 92% to like 71% protection. So, if that keeps up, it's just more evidence that you need a booster for the Pfizer vaccine. Moderna we'll hear about next month.
We're not talking about Johnson & Johnson, though. What about the effectiveness of that long term?
Well, we've known from the beginning that it's not as strong, and they got about 71% protection, and that seems to be lasting. But, they came on at the end. It does protect you from hospitalization at that rate. That continues as long as they've been following those patients. The mortality rate is the same as the other two vaccines. So for the severe disease, the Johnson & Johnson works pretty good. And we'll be hearing more about them in the next couple of months, too.
All right, viewer questions. How come we aren't hearing about big COVID outbreaks after sold-out stadiums to see college and pro football games?
That's because we haven't been having big outbreaks after the football games, which is really good news. We didn't have the big outbreaks after Lollapalooza either. So what do these things have in common? Well, Lollapalooza had to have, everybody had to be vaccinated or show a recent test. Now, the college games, you don't have that. But, the vaccination rates in many places are higher, and it is outdoors. I don't know. It's a great sign that we can get away with those kind of big outdoor activities.
Next year, we're going to have to go to Lollapalooza, so you know that it's pronounced Lollapalooza, Dr. Murphy. The kids are going to take issue with that.
Lollapalooza.
L-A. Yeah, there we go. Well, anyway, let me get on to the next question. How are numbers ever going to go down if you can still get COVID if you're vaccinated?
Good question, but it's all about the rate of infection. So if you're vaccinated compared to unvaccinated, you're 5 times less likely to get infected, 10 times less likely to be hospitalized, and 11 times less likely to die from this disease.
All right, so here's a good question. Some people had reactions to the second shot. Will the booster be like the first or the second for side effects?
We have limited experience with this third shot. There are people that had immunocompromised conditions have already been approved to get a third shot. But from the little information we have, it looks like it's really no different from the first or second shot.
All right, Dr. Murphy, thanks again for joining us. If you didn't get your question answered by the doctor, he does answer them biweekly on Northwestern University's Institute for Global Health Facebook page. You can also submit questions via email or post them on our